Hello, hello. It's a pleasure to be here sharing this Bible study with you yet again. Today we're going to be looking at question numbers 69 and 70 of the Westminster Larger Catechism. Question 69, as you may have here, you should have received this PDF with question 69 and question 70 of the Westminster Larger Catechism. So, let me make a note that question 69 will be quite short, okay? And this question here is the summary. Question 69 is the summary of questions 70 until 81, okay? So whatever we see on question 69 will be seen again in detail from all the way from question 70, which is the next one, which we hope to do right after, and all the way until question number 81, okay? So let us pray and let us begin this Bible study. Blessed be your holy name, O Lord God Almighty. We thank you, O Lord, for your loving kindness upon us, for your presence as your people study your scriptures through the assistance of the Holy Spirit. Oh Lord, we pray that you may enlighten our minds, expand our minds to see the beauty of your word, the beauty of the work of Christ. Oh Lord, and therefore may we love him more in return. For the more one knows of Christ, the better one may love him. The better one will love him. For he is perfectly desirable, perfectly great, merciful, kind, righteous, and he loves his church perfectly. O Lord, blessed be your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us begin then with question number 69. Question number 69, what is the communion in grace which the members of the invisible church have with Christ? So what is this communion? What is enjoyed on this communion that the members of the invisible church have with Christ? And the answer is, the communion in grace which the members of the invisible church have with Christ is their partaking of the virtue of his mediation in their justification, adoption, sanctification, and whatever else in this life manifests their union with him. Now, let us look at this answer in detail a little bit for now, and then we'll look at the biblical evidence. Now, the first, on the beginning of the answer, the communion in grace which the members of the invisible church have with Christ is their partaking of the virtue of his mediation. So, the communion in grace that the members of the invisible church have with Jesus allows them to enjoy the virtue of the work of Christ's mediation. So, it looks like I'm just repeating myself, but whatever Christ does, whatever the benefits are coming from the mediation of Christ. Mediation means the work of being a mediator, okay? So whatever the work of this mediator, Christ, whatever the results of this work are, without a doubt, always applied to the members of the invisible church. And please note that the list we have here, justification, adoption, sanctification, is not a complete list. It's even stated on the end of the answer. Whatever else in this life manifests their union with him, with Christ. So these are just a few of the benefits that the believer, the born-again believer, enjoys because Christ is his mediator, okay? You cannot, let me say this in a different way. You cannot have Christ for a mediator and not have the benefits that Christ gives. It's not that, oh, I have Christ as a mediator, and now I also must look after the benefits and try to receive the benefits. No. Once Christ is one's mediator, it is inevitable and impossible that that person will not receive the benefits of that mediation. Now let us look at the biblical evidence. Let us see if the word of, if the Bible exactly speaks exactly what we have been noting so far. Romans chapter 8, verse 30. Moreover, whom he predestined, whom God predestined, of course, these, so these people, these predestined people, so of course we're talking about the members of the invisible church. The members of the invisible church are all those that Christ have predestined, past, present, and future. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. We also talked about this not long ago. We call this the effectual calling. All those that Christ predestined, he called in such a way and worked in such a way that that person, the called person, will not resist. Not that God is doing violence towards their will, not that God is treating them as robots, but Christ shows himself to them, manifests himself to them in such a way that they will fail to resist, ultimately. The resistance will be put on initially, but God's attraction will win on the end of the day. The end of the process, I mean, of course. So, moreover, whom he predestined, this he also called. Whom he called, this he also justified. And whom he justifies, this he also glorified. Now, remember that I said that the list is not complete, okay? So we have justification, adoption, sanctification. And now here is Paul saying that the result of the work of the mediator is justification. And one day in glory, of course, the full glorification. That glorification somewhat begins here, but it's only complete in glory. Okay? So those who are justified of Christ, they are at once justified and they are in a state of waiting for the full glory that will be theirs. Now notice this. If Jesus is the bride, if Jesus is the bridegroom and the church is the bride, and we see on Genesis chapter 2 that there will be one flesh. There will be one flesh. God even took Eve out of Adam, and in the marital union, they are made, by virtue of the marital union, they are made one flesh. So we look at the relationship of Christ and the church. And by the way, marriage mirrors that. The husband is supposed to be like Christ is to the church towards his wife. And the wife is supposed to be towards the husband, as the church is supposed to be towards Christ. So observe that there is this mirroring. One is mirroring the other. So if the husband and the wife are made one, and we see that Christ marries the church, he is the bridegroom, the church is the bride, there is a marriage. There is a marriage to be, of course, fully actualized in glory. So we see that there'll be one. So that all the benefits of Christ will be for the church. So that there'll be in such a way, because of this, in virtue of this union, whatever Christ has, whatever the benefits that the person of Christ enjoys, the church will also enjoy. You see the beauty. I'm not saying that humans will become divine. I'm not saying this. This is heresy. Divinity is divinity. Humanity is humanity. There is no change in their being. There's no fundamental change on the state of their being. They'll be on their morals, on their inclinations, on their desires. But you will not cease to be you. And you will not cease to have your humanity. Of course, it will be a completely transformed humanity in heaven, but humanity nevertheless. So we see that this Romans chapter 8, verse 30, really proves that the theologians of Westminster were correct, that those who are members of the invisible church, the predestined, they are justified, and by virtue of their justification, benefits shall follow. In this case here, glorification. Let us look for the benefits, okay? Adoption, for example, the reference number 284, adoption. Ephesians 1:5, having predestined us, now observe, predestined, okay, members of the invisible church, people that will one day in time and history be born again. One may be predestined, but he may not be converted yet. But one day in his life, I don't know when, they will be. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the pleasure of his will. So see, all those who are members of the invisible church, they are adopted. So they are justified. They are adopted. And we'll see on 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, the last reference of this question, we'll see the following. But of him you are in Christ Jesus. So, once again, he's talking about members of the invisible church, those who are in Christ Jesus. Once somebody is really in Christ Jesus, he cannot cease to be in Christ Jesus. Christ doesn't divorce his wife. None. None of those who belong to the church will be divorced of Christ. No, none. Who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. So you see here, those who are in Christ, they will have that Christ who is the wisdom of God, the righteousness of God, the sanctification of God, and the redemption of God. So once one is born again, once he is taken into the invisible church, he receives from Christ wisdom, redemption, justification, righteousness, all this, okay? Now, is the work of the mediator complete? That's a question that I want to add. Is the work of Christ complete? Yes, the work of Christ is a complete work. Christ doesn't need to do anything else in addition to his work. What Christ does now is the maintenance of what he conquered by virtue of his passive and active obedience. Passive meaning he endured what he was supposed to endure, and active meaning he did what he was supposed to do. All Christ does now is the maintenance of what he achieved with his work. And of course, that is done through his work of mediator in heaven even. He sits at the right hand of God. He is a lawyer to his people. And from heaven, him and God together sent the Holy Spirit. That's a clause that on Christian documentation of the past, or on councils, they wrote filioque. Filioque meaning proceeding. So he proceeds, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, filioque. So the Holy Spirit is sent by the Father and by Christ. He is sent to the Christian, and being in the Christian, the Holy Spirit constantly and never ceasing puts the spotlight in Christ. The work of the Holy Spirit is not to put the light, the spotlight in himself. The work of the Holy Spirit is to shine the light on Christ. As to shine the light on Christ. So, is the work of Jesus complete? Yes, the work is complete, but the manifestation of this work and the application of this work, which of course is applied unto people who live on time and space, therefore this application will be seen on time and space. Therefore, there are different times. So the work of the Holy Spirit, the work of justification will be seen in some people at a specific moment in their lives and other people at other specific moments of their lives. There is no such thing as a set time for everybody to be, okay? Every believer will become, every predestined person will become a believer at when they turn 20 years old. There is no such a thing. We do not know when that will be. We do not know when God will save all those that he wants to save, but indeed he will save. Indeed he will save. So the work of Christ is complete in the sense that Christ doesn't need to add to his work. He doesn't need to do more. All he does now is to maintain what he already did and to apply to the predestined people when, on a specific time and date, time and place, his work. That has already come for many, that is still to come for many others. Okay? So, why am I emphasizing this? I'm emphasizing this because I want to make it absolutely crystal clear. The work of justification is a one-off. Listen to this. The work of a justification is a single act that happens. It is not a continuous, it's not a progressive act. It is not, there is no continuation of justification. Justification is one single definite declaration made by God. God, at a specific time, declares a person that he chose to apply the work of Christ. On that time, God declares a person justified. That's a very important word, okay? He is declared justified. The justice of Christ, the righteousness of Christ is imputed. Observe that I'm using a legal language, a judicial vocabulary here. So God, at a specific moment, applies that. Sanctification is different. Sanctification begins when the person is born again and proceeds for the rest of the person's life. Justification is not a progressive work. Justification is a single momentary, I mean, it's done in a moment, that's what I mean. Not that the consequences are for a moment, I don't mean that. I mean that it's done, it's an act that has a beginning, middle, and end. It's a declaration. Justification is a one-off. Sanctification is progressive. Those are very different things that must never be confounded. They must never be confused or taken one for the other. Never. If we fail to recognize this, then we will be saying that person such and such is being saved, or he's working for the salvation, or that the work of salvation began, but it's not complete. No. Or one is justified or is not justified. Or one is born again or is not born again. Or one is alive for Christ or dead for Christ. There is no half dead or half alive. Or is alive or it's not. It's like pregnancy. Have you ever seen a person that is a little bit pregnant? That doesn't really work, does it? Or it is or it isn't. So, or the person is justified or not, or guilty or innocent. No middle ground. It's a declaration. Now, sanctification is different. That must be crystal clear. We are studying the Westminster Larger Catechism. This is a reformed document. It's a document from the Protestant Reformation. More towards the end. Not. I don't mean that in the sense that this document was made in the beginning of the Protestant Reformation, which was on the 15th and 16th century. This document is of a later stage. Some call it the post-Reformation, which was on the 17th century. So this document is a reformed document, and reformed theology is very clear in this. Justification is a single event. Sanctification is a progression. One is sanctified more and more and more and more to the point that in one stage he has a certain amount of sanctification. At a later stage, that sanctification is much greater, it's much larger. Once somebody begins his walk with Christ, let's say his sanctification, his holiness level, allow me this crude language here, not crude, but very basic, very blunt. His level of sanctification is this big. And as he walks with Christ, it increases and it grows and it starts to look more and more and more like Christ. It's a progressive transformation. But in terms of being born again, one cannot be more born again than another. Have you ever seen a baby that is more born or less born than another baby? A human that is, oh, this human here is really born. That one, not so much born. What is or it isn't, okay? So what is justification? Question number 70. Let's go to question number 70. You should have this one here with you. What is justification? I'm sure I already have answered this question quite a bit by my previous monologue, the monologue that you just heard. Justification is an act of God's free grace unto sinners, in which he pardons all their sins, accepts and accounts their persons righteous in his sight, not for anything wrought in them or done by them, but only for the perfect obedience and full satisfaction of Christ, by God imputed to them and received by faith alone. Now observe this. Look at the beginning of this answer. Justification is an act, not a progression, okay? An act of God's free grace unto sinners. It's an act, not a process. Let's look at the biblical references for this first portion here. Justification is an act of God's free grace unto sinners. Romans chapter 3, verses 23 until verse 25. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace. Now look at this, an act that is based on grace and not on merit. Okay? So justification is an act of God's free grace, not a meritorious act, not a payment, not like you shake my hand and I'll shake yours, you know? Like, we help each other. There is a synergy going on. No. It's a unilateral. Unilateral means one side, meaning one side only. A unilateral work of God. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith. See? Through faith. To demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed. Okay. We have the part that is a very rich three verses here, okay? Verses 23, 24, and 25. There's a lot of theological richness here. I only want to emphasize, okay, just to give an idea of how rich these verses are. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Why it doesn't say fall short of the standards of God or the morals of God? It says fall short of the glory of God. Sin is to not be like God. It's to act not like God would act. It's to be like God would not be. It's to differ from God. Now, when the law is given, the law is not, it's not to say, I mean, it's saying also, this is how you shall live. But the utmost purpose of the law is to say, here's how God is. When we would apply that to a human reality, here's how God would be. So see this and be likewise. So learn this and be likewise. Like Jesus said, you shall be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Jesus commands his church to be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. Okay, so how is the perfection of God? And the perfection of God is described in Ten Commandments. Just one simple example here. When it comes to desires, we see that God is it's perfectly balanced. It's perfectly in peace with his own desires. There's nothing internally in God that pulls him to a direction that he should not be going. There is a perfect harmony in God's inner being. The 10th commandment shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. If your innermost desires, if your passions, if your emotions are in balance, are in peace, are focused on the Lord, if they belong to Christ and not to yourself, if they imitate Christ, you will not desire what belongs to somebody else. You may see what somebody else have and say, oh, that looks wonderful. I shall strive to have that. That's no problem. But you say, I want that one. I want the thing that belongs to my neighbor. That is a violation of the 10th commandment. Now observe that the commandment is not a category. It's not a neatly divided category. The commandment is just simply saying, God is so in peace with himself, he's so perfect with himself, he's so aligned with himself, and it's so balanced, it's so harmonious, that his emotions, his desires are of peace, peaceful, generous, and they wish the best. And you should do so likewise. Therefore, do not desire what belongs to your neighbor. Be happy for your neighbor. And more, in whatever depends on you, see for the prosperity of your neighbor. Another example. The 9th commandment. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Especially against your neighbor, but no false witness in any way, shape, or form. So we see that that commandment is not speaking about how we should be only. Of course, it does say that. But that commandment is first and foremost saying, behold the beauty of God. Behold the glory of God. God is perfectly truthful in his statements. God speaks the truth. God is the truth. That's what the commandment is saying. God is the truth. So because God is the truth, so whenever you open your mouth, truth should come out. And if it doesn't, you fall short of the glory of God, because the glory of God is truth. That's what the 9th commandment is saying. The commandments are mostly teaching us how God is, how his glory is. See, the commandments, they do appear like categories that are neatly divided and one doesn't touch the other. They may appear so, but they are not that. They are simply saying, here's how God is on many areas. Of course, nothing can explain God fully. Can I say, oh, the 10 commandments, they explain God completely. They explain the glory of God completely. No, that would be a heresy. Because you'd be saying that the infinite God could fit in the Holy Book. Now, the Holy Book teaches me and you all that we need to know about God. Now, observe that God is infinite. There are much more about God that it's not written in the Holy Book. Now, the Holy Book is the only sure way, is the only source of knowledge of God that is inherent. That is free of error. So that's the only source that we can go, that we are sure that is not distorted. Now, God is infinite. We will spend eternity learning about him. He cannot be contained. Even the writer of the Gospel of John himself, he said, if you were to write all the things that Jesus did, I fear that the whole world do not contain the books. Now, these are merely the actions. These are merely the, not the being of God. So, all we have right now in this life is the Bible, because this is what we have, and we can be sure that it's correct. In heaven, we will learn even more. So, you see how rich this verse is. For the purposes of the present study, here's what we are seeing. We have sinned. We don't have the glory of God anymore. We fall short because on his glory is perfect truth. It's perfect balance, inner balance. It's perfect aligned and harmonious desires. He's not in conflict with himself. He's free from passions. Let me put it this way. He's free from passions. All that he wants in the right amount. All he doesn't want in the right amount, if there is ever such a thing. He's harmonious. That is the glory of God. But we are not like this. Therefore, we fell short from his glory. We have sinned. Now, how can we be, and this is not what God wants. How can we ever be in peace with God? How can we ever be friends of God if he is so above and we are so below? If he is perfection itself and we are in imperfection itself. Allow me the poetic license here. If we are so imperfect, how can we ever stand in his presence? If he is a being that is pure, that is... The Bible says that there is no sin in God. The angels beholding God, they sang, holy, 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 which in Hebrew is a superlative, right? The holiest. So the angels looked at God and they saw holiness, and holiness to the uttermost. Nothing is holier than God. And we are so not that. Therefore, justification is a must. They're justified freely by his grace. Observe that this justification is by virtue of imputation. It's imputed on your account, or upon you. It's placed on your shoulders, okay? Let us look at Romans 4, verse 5. But to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. Look at this word, accounted. Considered as, viewed as, taken as righteousness. I hope it's clear here. I hope you are really observing that we have legal language in play here. We have a judicial terminology being used. The believer, once his God gives him life, he quickens him, he gives life. The act of justification is not God saying, oh, you really are just. I see in you justice. I see that you are righteous. No. No. Uh-uh. We are found guilty. But then comes the work of Christ. And the work of Christ is imputed on our choice. It's imputed to us. It's placed on our account. See? Accounted. Put on the account. So the work of Christ is given to us. It's deposited on our account. By virtue of that, the one that is found guilty, that was found guilty, it's now declared, not out of his own merits, he is not found righteous, he is found guilty, but declared righteous. Why? Because he's now united with Christ, and being united with Christ, he has all the merits of Christ. And having the merits of Christ, he will have one very powerful thing, which is the offer of sacrifice that God desires. Because on our sin, we have tipped the scales against us. And the problem is the sin has an infinite weight because it's against an infinite God. Now, to balance the scales, an infinite gift must be given. How do you count? How do you balance the accounts that have infinity in one side? You have to place infinity on the other side. So the infinite offense is counterbalanced with an infinite gift, infinitely precious gift. And Christ puts that on the account of the believer. So, you see, it's not of the believer. The believer is not the righteous one. No, no. You are not righteous, but you are called so because of the virtue of Christ, because of what Christ does, because of what Christ does, not you. So the judge, the God Almighty, the Father, he looks at that and declares the believer to be righteous. Now observe, he was found guilty because his account was on the red. But because of the infinitely red, but the infinitely whiteness, I'm taking the whiteness, I'm taking from that verse, that Christ, the blood of Christ, purifies our hearts and makes white as snow. White being a symbol of purity. For example, you take a white sheet. You take a white sheet and say, oh, there's no maculation here. There is no stain. So you come and there you go. You stain it. You stained it. Now, the blood of Christ covers all. Now, if you have ever seen a snowfall, you see that, especially a heavy snowfall, the ground, the landscape may be all dirty. Maybe a battle took place. And the scenario is dreadful. And then comes a heavy, heavy, thick snowfall. And all you look is white. It's covered. The slate is blank again. That's the work of Christ. He brings the purity to the heart of the Christian. So he that was found guilty is now declared to be righteous. Now, one that is declared righteous, will that one stay in prison? Obviously not. Once the judge declares, now you see, judges, they don't declare people to be guilty. Judges, they found, you can see on a court, a judge will say to a guilty person, I have found you to be guilty. I have analyzed the case against you. I have heard your defense and the defense and the accusation. And I have found, see, the judge is not making up stuff. He's just stating what was discovered. I have found you to be guilty. And we are found to be guilty. Because God looks at our case. And we are found guilty. But to some comes Christ as their mediator. And then God will say, however, a deposit of infinite value was made on your account. Because of that deposit on your account, I declare that from now on, you are justified. You are righteous from now on. You may go free. That is the celestial court, so to speak. It's a declaration. It's a forensic. It's a judicial, a legal declaration that God makes, not a process. Justification is an act of God's free grace unto sinners in which he pardons all their sins, accepts and accounts, see, put into the account, their persons righteous in his sight. So he looks at them and says, no, you are now considered. I'm going to count you as righteous. I'm going to put you in this category. You're guilty, but because of what Christ did, not you, not because of what you did, because of what Christ did, for you, I'm going to place you in a different category, which is the category of justified. You may walk free. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 19 and verse 21. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Now, Christ is found innocent, and sin is imputed on his account. We are found guilty. And righteousness of Christ, when I say we, I'm talking about all those who are born again. And the righteousness of Christ is imputed on the righteous to them on their account, and is given to them as righteousness. So you see, God made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us. Jesus, which is not sinful, never was, never will be, he was transferred, he took our position. He took our category, the category of guilty, of sinful, of condemned. He took that category, and he took all the punishment of it. He absorbed all the fury of hell. What is the fury of hell? The fury of God himself. Who is the Lord of hell? God, not the devil. The devil is the greatest prisoner of a jail, huge, massive jail called the hell. How does that jail look like? That jail is the absence of all the virtues of God. That is that hell. Therefore, the fury of that prison, the fury of the Lord of that prison, the fury of hell was poured on Christ. He absorbed it. He received it all. A human will never be able to handle that. A human would be crushed, annihilated. But because, yeah, indeed, he is human to represent us, but he's also God. To handle the weight of the fury that is infinite. How bad was God's anger? Impossible to describe. Why? Because it's infinite. Doesn't matter how bad of a picture we paint, it will never scratch the surface. It's infinite. How do you picture infinity? Well, it's unpicturable. It's undescribable. God took that because he's also undescribable. He's also unpicturable, if there is ever such a word. He's infinite. So he took that. He absorbed that fury. He took the category into himself. He took the category of sinful to himself, you see? He made him, Jesus, God made Jesus, the Father made Jesus, who knew no sin, Jesus knew no sin, to be sin for us. So he took our category. And the category that was his was given to us. Look at this. That we, who is Paul saying we here? He's including himself and all others who are born again. We might become the righteousness of God in him. So it's a categorical swap. A swap of accounts. All the debt on our account was deposited on Christ. His benefits were deposited in our account. So a declaration is made. Jesus will be declared sinful, not because he is. He's not sinful. Never was. But he will be declared that so that he may receive the penalty. Now the church is sinful, but will be declared just. Now, you may think, Felipe, that's not fair. It was Jesus' desire to do that. Did Jesus go to the cross kicking and screaming? No. He didn't want to go initially. Yeah, he didn't. He cried. He prayed to his Father. If possible, pass away from me this cup, this chalice, this glass of your filled with your wrath, with the drink of your wrath, if possible, pass it from me. But nevertheless, your will, not mine. What was that? Now that's Jesus showing that he's a healthy person. Who is to be desired? Who is to desire pain? Who is to desire suffering? That was Jesus showing, suffering I don't want. Pain I don't want. Never did, never will. but I will take it for the love of my people. So, who is to say to Jesus, Jesus, you are unfair? He willingly went to the cross, not desiring, and yet he took himself there. He even said, if I cry out to my Father, he would send a host of angels to liberate me. Did he ever say, oh God, send the angels now? He never said that. As a healthy person, he did not want pain. As a very, very, as an infinitely phenomenal, loving God, he endured the pain for the sake of his people. The rest of our study is pretty much this. The rest of our verses here will simply say this. Romans 3, 22, 24 to 25, 27 to 28. Even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all. See, deposited. On all who believe. For there is no difference, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood. Propitiation means to appease, right? To make one propitious. I don't know if this word would work in English. In Portuguese, this word works very well. To make one positive towards another. Set forth as a propitiation by his blood, through faith to demonstrate his righteousness. Because in his forbearance, God has passed over the sins that were previously committed. We saw this a few minutes ago. What is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith, apart from the deeds of the law. So you see, justified. He is declared just by faith. So it's an act that is received based on a belief. Belief on what? Believe on the work of a third party. Who is that third party? Jesus. Not for, going back to the question, to the answer, not for any wrought in them or done by them. Titus chapter 3, verse 5 and 7. Not by works of righteousness which we have done. See? Not by works, not by ours. The works of Christ, not ours. But according to his mercy, he saved us. Through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, that having been justified, you see the term, the time, the tense of this verb, having been justified. This verb here in Greek speaks of a complete action in the past, not an ongoing action, an action that began in the past and continues until today. It's a verb that speaks of an action that began in the past and ended in the past. A complete action. An action that is not progressive. That is not progressive until today, until now. It is not something that is still taking place. It's something that completely took place in the past. Having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Justification is a one act. It's a one action. Not two, not ongoing, not a process. It's complete on the past. The past of those who are born again, of course. The past of those who have been transformed and renewed by Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. See? Forgiveness according to the riches of his grace. Not in anything that we have, but on his work alone. Going back to the answer. Reference 289, you see? But only for the perfect obedience and full satisfaction of Christ by God imputed. See, imputation? To them. Now let's look at the biblical references. Romans chapter 5, verse 17 to 19. For if this passage here is so clear, for if by the one man's offense, Adam, the first Adam, the husband of Eve, you know. For if by the one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so through one man's righteous act, that's the second Adam, Jesus Christ, the husband of the church, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men. You see, what that one Jesus did, that one Messiah, that act came to all of those who were justified, resulting in justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience many will be made righteous. You see here, because of the obedience of Christ, we are made righteous, not our own works. Salvation can never be earned. Salvation is given. Salvation is received. God gives, the predestined person receives. Never earned. All your works without the mercies of God are nothing. Once you are saved, then you do work. But then you already have salvation. Good works are only achievable by people that have already been redeemed, already been born again. You will never be born again by your power. Dead people do nothing. Once you're alive, then you do good works. But not for salvation, because you're already being saved. You're already transformed. You're already redeemed. You do good works because then you are redeemed. Romans chapter 4, verses 6 to 8. Just as David also describes the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. You see? Blessedness of the man whom God imputes righteousness. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. It's an imputation. It's a legal declaration made upon somebody else. Going back to the answer of the question of the catechism on the end. So this act of justification, the imputation of justification, the imputation of righteousness upon the believer is received by faith alone. Acts chapter 10, verse 43. To him all the prophets witness that through his name, whoever believes in him will receive remission of sins. But that's not difficult to understand, is it? That's the terms are very clear. Whoever believes in him, that's it. Those are the only ones. No more, no less. Galatians 2:16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. You see, by the works of the law, no flesh. No. The only work that counts for salvation is the work of Christ. He, the work of Christ, counts for the salvation of the church. That's the only case. Your works. By the way, you can only do works once you're saved. I'll say this again. You can only do works once you're already saved. Before you're saved, you cannot work. Oh, Felipe, I see a lot of atheists donating money to charities or doing wonderful, beautiful things. That's called civil good. Good according to the Bible. Real, real good according to the Bible. It depends on what is done. It depends on why it's done. And it depends on who does it. If it's not by faith, the Bible says that without faith it's impossible to please God. If he's an atheist, how will he please God? Therefore, he cannot work. Galatians chapter 2. No, I already read Galatians. Excuse me. Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. Our last verse for this study. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. inherent righteousness only exists in Christ, not ours. The Bible clearly states, your righteousness are as filthy rags. Now, filthy rag is the most, it's a very graphic thing. That thing is chosen for a reason. Because there's nothing beautiful in it. There's nothing desirable in it. It is filthy. That's the works of the unregenerate. Let us pray and let us give thanks to God for the work that only He can do, and He does. And He did, and He applies to His church. Blessed be your holy name, O Lord God Almighty. For because of what you have done through your life and your death, because of that work, because you worked, the church can be saved. The church will be saved. The invisible church will be saved. Lord, thank you for the declaration. Thank you for declaring that your children are justified. Thank you for imputing our sins to Christ and imputing His righteousness to us. Thank you, Father, thank you, Son, and thank you, Holy Spirit. Blessed be the Most Holy Trinity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. God keep you. Bye-bye.